came from North Carolina to Texas for a couple of reasons, the main one being this collection of books, which are the various covers of books over a fairly long lifetime that I packed up along with all my papers and photographs and tapes and a couple of films I made to send for safekeeping at the Harry Ransom Center over in Austin. A truck came by my house just a week ago, and carted it all away, and I made this collection of photographs of book covers to help the bibliographers sort what was in each of the boxes. So as you can see, a lot of those topics are about Vietnam, and one of them has to do with the topic that Tom Keener was mentioning, working with an ancient script and translating some of the poems that were written in it. And so I'll talk about that, some of those, for a little bit. But really, the new book that I have tonight that I hope you'll buy is a new book of poetry that has almost nothing in it about Vietnam. After all, the war was over a long time ago, and many of us have made our peace with it one way or the other. But I did get a request to read a poem that came out a few years ago, maybe 10, 20, I'm not sure. It's called For the Missing in Action. I'd gone back to Vietnam with a couple of veterans, a Marine and a guy from the Army, both of them poets, Bill Earhart and Bruce Weigel. And we were the guest of a Vietnamese general who was head of the War Crimes Commission. And he was interested, as all of the Vietnamese government was at the time, in kind of reparations and also reconciliation with Americans. And so we were an early group to be admitted. And he took us south, because at the time the Vietnamese were fighting in Cambodia. We went south into the Mekong Delta, where a lot of the time I spent in Vietnam was spent. And we went to this one small village that had been attacked by Cambodians from across the Mekong. And then at another village, it was the same place. People were talking about the remnants of the war in their own lives. The poem was called For the Missing in Action, and more or less it's a poem from the pieces of information these villagers were talking about that day when the war was over and we were there. Hazed with heat and harvest dusk, the air swam with flying husks as men whacked rice sheaves into bins. And all across the sun-struck fields, red flags hung from bamboo poles. Beyond the last tree line on the horizon, beyond the coconut palms and eucalyptus, out in the moon zone, puckered by bombs, the dead earth where no one ventures, the boys found it. Foolish boys, riding buffaloes in crater lands, where at night bombs thump and ghosts howl. A green patch on the raw earth. And now they've led the farmers here, the kerchiefed women in baggy pants, the men with sickles and flails, children herding ducks with switches, all staring from a crater berm, silent. In that dead place, the weeds had formed a man, where someone died and fertilized the earth with flesh and blood, with tears, with longing for loved ones. No scrap remained, not even a buckle survived the monsoons, just a green creature, a viney man, supine, with posies for eyes, butterflies for buttons, and a lily for a tongue. Now, when huddled asleep together, the farmers hear a rustly footfall as the leaf man rises and stumbles to them. There is one poem about Vietnam in this recent book. And it has some sections of prose. I'll read that first section. It's also about going back and visiting the place. Let me see if I can find it. Returning after our war. This is the prose introduction. And it has an epigraph, a little quote at the beginning from Graham Greene's book, Ways of Escape. He says, but in Indochina, I drained a magic potion, a loving cup, which I have shared since with many retired Cologne and officers of the French Foreign Legion, whose eyes light up at the mention of Saigon and Hanoi. Saigon. The other night, I went with friends to see the Saigon River, where it loops past the venerable Majestic Hotel, still standing on the riverbank at the end of the modernized old downtown. From the hotel's top floor balcony, we looked across to the Nha Bea side, where back in the American days, rockets were sometimes launched at the city from the mangrove swamps across the way. We stood a while saying nothing, just watching the boats chugging slowly behind dim bow lights as a full moon floated above the river. During the war, the street behind the Majestic was, architecturally speaking, still a colonial avenue of small shops, GI bars, cafes, Maxim's nightclub, still there, and a green-shuttered appartement with yellow stuccoed walls leaking blotches of mildew. And now it's a dazzle of luxury hotels and skyscrapers. Downtown Saigon is nearly unrecognizable, but every now and then, my taxi would turn a corner, stirring up a memory of some distant encounter, an argument in a government ministry, a flower market where I once bought a pair of finches, or simply our corner cigarette stall, where a woman, a gold-toothed old lady, sold Marlboros tapped with marijuana. Behind the Majestic, the old Graham Greene apartment is gone, though one remembers the man who prepared Greene's opium, still climbing the creaky wooden steps into the early 1970s to serve Americans with his valise of pipes. And now, after many reinventions, it's become a garish complex of glass and metal called Katina, as the global imperium changed hands over the decades, and the Rue Katinat became Tu Ya, or Freedom Street, and then, after the war, Dam Coi, or Great Uprising, and Saigon became Ho Chi Minh City. So this poem is about, this book, I should say, is about empire. I'll try this one more thing that Kevin back there might put up for us. So let you hear something of that period of my life. Here we go. So during the war, or while the war was still going on, I traveled around with a tape recorder and collected sung poetry on tape. And it was poetry in an oral tradition, transmitted by song, memorized that way, captured on the melodies that differ region to region. And I would go up to people and, as strange as it might say, considering that I was an American and this was our war, I would ask farmers and women at sewing machines to sing their favorite song. And they would, because they thought these songs were important. It was important to, about revealing who they were and what they believed in their very basic humanity. And so I traveled about. I had to be careful where I was going. The war was going on very much. It was 1971, 72. And on the tapes that I also left at the Harry Ransom Center this last Monday. On some of them you can hear in the background of the singing mortar fire, a firefight going on across the river. We were usually recorded at night because that's the farmers worked all day, and they kept singing nonetheless. So the first song is, I think I have a copy here, it's readable from up here, is about the Saigon River. And it goes something like this in Vietnamese. Som Saigon chai yai cho co, nuoc men mom nuoc do phu sa, ngot ngao ngot luon bac nac hung tong hung lu quen ya. And my voice, I can't sing in any language, but I'm going to play for you what it, how it was recorded in just a minute. Here's the English. The Saigon River slides past the old market, its broad waters thick with silt. There the rice shoots gather fragrance, the fragrance of my country home, recalling my mother home, stirring deep love. It was sung by a monk like those two men in the picture, because this was a religious island that I was recording at then. And I remember trying to take a picture of them, because I tried to get a picture of everybody I recorded. And the man on the left there said, absolutely not, absolutely not. And I said, why, what's the, and he said, he was a Viet Cong. He's deserted the Viet Cong. If this picture gets out or anybody knows he's here, one side or the other, we'll take him away. But let's play it. You'll see, he had a great voice.
Sông Sài Gòn chảy dài chớ câu, nước mênh mông nước đổ phù sa, ngọt ngào ngọn lúa bát ngát hương thơm hương lúa của quê nhà. Họ
so there's a pagoda bell in the background. The he's talking about, it's a political poem. It's just subtly political. Vietnamese can smell their native home in the steam coming off rice, which is cooked, boiled in the river and creeks by their homes. Those creeks all have a different sniff to them. In fact, during the war, I remember there was a time when South Vietnam, which used to export rice to the world, became by force an importer of American Louisiana long grain rice, because there wasn't enough rice being cultivated anymore. And Vietnamese in restaurants in Saigon rioted when they smelled the rice off those rice bowls and realized to what degree their country had been weakened even to its food sources. So what you see in front of us is somewhat remarkable. This song not only had never been written down before, but none of these songs, or almost all of them, none of them had been written down before. In the little book that I did of them, of some 50 poems, only four had ever appeared ever in print anywhere, usually from scholars in the North, well before our war with Vietnam. So I needed someone who could write them, someone from the dialect area itself, and also that someone who's usually like the monk on the left, who knew the area and could say, as he once did, it's not safe to go there. We were once going to go on a trip into Cambodia to the Seven Mountains area to record there as well. He said, not safe, not for anybody, not for you. So I recorded it in Kanta and near Mita on this river island, above Kanta in the countryside. I recorded in Hue and not in Saigon really, because country people were too distressed there to ask them anything, And the city people just didn't learn this kind of tradition anymore. The other thing that Tom mentioned was a tradition of writing that derives, it's hard to say it how it derives, around 900 AD, Vietnamese scholars who were fluent in Chinese, which was the writing system of the country at the time, in a country where most people did not read or write, but a small literary group did, those trained as scholars and mandarins. And they wrote in Chinese, but they were patriotic. They wanted to write in their own language. Chinese couldn't do that. They could write Chinese ideas and concepts, but basic Vietnamese words weren't available in that ideogrammatic script. So they created one for themselves. And they wrote in that from about 900 AD, where we see the first inscriptions, into the 19th century. And a woman who lived around 1800, who flourished around 1800, was maybe one of the last great writers in that tradition. And after I worked on these folk poems, I was encouraged by Vietnamese scholars to try her work, partly because the word stock of this folk poetry, if you figure out the percentage of foreign words to native Vietnamese words, is very much a native Vietnamese word stock, with very few borrowings from Chinese, which would be the literary poetry in the literary world. But this is a poetry sung by farmers, fishermen. They liked that first book, encouraged me on. This was Prince Bu Hoi, who at one point, when I first met him, had been Minister of Health in South Vietnam, when his brother was the Minister of Health in North Vietnam, and their mother was the abbess of the Buddhist nuns in Hue. What a family. They would have been part of the royal court in a previous century. Well, Prince Bu Hoi encouraged me to go on to Ho Xuân Hương, and so did an historian, Lê Thanh Coy. So I gave it a try. I realized that they tricked me because she's far more complex, wickedly complex and funny. Let me find a poem of hers before I move on to the new book. This is a different tradition altogether. And Tom was saying I translated it, and but you don't translate a language. You can translate works in the language, and I chose this one poet. And then I realized that this one poet was just one poet from a great tradition, and there were hundreds of others in books that were rotting away or in private attics or in some cases in museums and libraries. So with two Vietnamese friends skilled in linguistics and mathematics, we developed a writing system, a computer system that could print this script that Vietnamese used for almost 1,000 years and make it available on the internet. Also, once it was digitized, that meant we could go to those libraries and save the copies that were being rotting away, or when you opened them up, the bookworms fell onto your shoes with a clatter. So we created the Vietnamese Nam Preservation Foundation, and we functioned for 20 years. We digitized the whole National Library ancient texts collection, and then we went on to Buddhist temples. And that writing system is indeed related to the woman whose poetry, and the book of her poetry that I translated. So here's one of those poems. She almost always wrote two poems at once. In this sense, Vietnamese is a tonal language, so if you play with tones, you can get different meanings sometimes just by reversing words in the word order. All the poems that she wrote were in a form the Vietnamese called regulated verse, which is based on the Chinese prosodic form of regulated verse, a poem of 8 lines, rhyming on the first, second, fourth, sixth, and eighth lines, middle four lines having parallel syntactic structure, and often saying two things at once. A poem about old Mandarin men climbing a mountain turns out to be a poem about old Mandarins doing something naughty. And this poem has two meanings too, based on puns. So here it is in Vietnamese. Em ai chiu xuan toi can die. Lang lang chang bong chu tran ai. Ba hoi chiu mo chung gam shom. Mot vung tang tung nuk long troi. Bae ai ngan chung con tat gan. Ngun an mun chung zae koi vioi. Nao nao kuk lak la dao ta. Spring Watching Pavilion. A gentle spring evening arrives, airily, unclouded by worldly dust. Three times the bell tolls, echoes like a wave. We see heaven upside down in sad puddles. Love's vast sea cannot be emptied, and springs of grace flow easily everywhere. Where is Nirvana? Nirvana is here, 9 times out of 10. So I won't go into this with the puns, but basically she's arriving at Westlake in Hanoi. It rained during the day, the sun is out, and she's looking at the puddles at her feet, and she's watching clouds moving in them. In other words, what's down there is really up there. And this starts this thought pattern, and then it's ticked off by the ringing of a pagoda bell. Three times the bell tolls echoes like a wave. And then she puts it together. We see heaven upside down in sad puddles. And with that realization comes another. Love's vast sea cannot be emptied, and springs of grace flow easily everywhere. And she asks the straight out question, and now the language gets very marketplace and simple and direct. Where is Nirvana? Nirvana is here, 9 times out of 10. That is, if you can pay attention. So this background, interest in empires that rise and fall and figures within them led me to a new book, and we'll switch to that. I don't know, I guess I can't show you the cover. Can you see? No. These monumental heads. The cover is from a mountainside in southeastern Turkey called Nimrut, Nimrut Daj. Nimrut Daj is a place where all these immense heads of potentates and rulers and kings are on the mountainside crackling and falling apart under the frost and sun glare. And they were put there from kingdoms that lasted, that we don't even really have much sense of, unless you really dig, from the 2nd century BC into the 1st century AD. And I chose it because empires fade. There are these moments when there's a tremor, and nothing is quite the same afterwards. And so the poems in this new book may be affected from my background and things in Vietnam, but really they just move around the world into our own here and elsewhere. There's an epigraph to the book from Stefan Zweig, which given the declarations that we've heard on the news today, seem even more appropriate. And it's this, he says, our generation has gradually learned the great art of living without security. We are prepared for anything. There is a mysterious pleasure in retaining one's reason and spiritual independence, particularly in a period when confusion and madness are rampant. A finger. After most of the bodies were hauled away, And while the FBI and fire department and NYPD were still haggling about who was in charge, as smoke cleared, the figures in Tyvek suits came, gloved, gowned, masked, ghostly figures searching rubble for pieces of people, bagging, then sending the separate and commingled remains to the temporary morgue set up on site. This is where the snip of forefinger began its journey. Not alone, of course, but with thousands of other bits, not lost or barged off with a tonnage for sorting at the city landfill. A delicate tip, burnt and marked finger, distal. And then sent over to the medical examiners where forensic anthropologists sorted human from animal bones from trade center restaurants, all buried together in the Pompeian effect of incinerated dust. The bit of finger that might once have tapped text messages, potted a geranium, held a glass, stroked a cat, tugged a kite string along a beach, went to the bio lab where it was profiled, barcoded, and shelved in a Falcon tube. Memorial Park, that is to say, the parking lot behind the ME, drone with generators for the dozens of refrigerated trucks filling with human debris, while over on the Hudson at Pier 94, families brought toothbrushes or lined up for DNA swabbing. As the year passed, the unidentified remains were dried out in a desiccation room, humidity pumped out, heat raised high, shriveled, then vacuum sealed. But the fingertip had a DNA match in a swab from her brother. She was English, 30 years old. She worked on the 105th floor of the North Tower. The Times ran a bio. Friends posted blogs. Her father will not speak about it. Her mother planted a garden in Manhattan. In that garden is a tree. Some look on it and feel restored. Others, when the wind lifts its leaves, want to scream. After the inauguration 2013, this was President Obama's second inauguration, I was in Washington, and for some reason I was taking the train home to Raleigh, where I live, and this is about that train ride. It has an epigraph from the Epistle to the Hebrews, "Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins." Kind of a chilling piece of advice, right? And there's a reference to an event. Some black soldiers coming back from Vietnam, re-encountering North Carolina to a bad end. And the quote that I'll give you in the line comes from the court record. And the reference of the blood done sign my name is a great, great book of that event in prose by Tim, can't remember his name, Tim what. Any case, I'll start. After the inauguration, 2013, pulling from the tunnel at Union Station, our train shunts past DC offices and then crosses the rail bridge over the tidal Potomac, blooming in sweeps of sunlight. Except for me and two young guys in suits studying spreadsheets on their laptops, and the tattooed girl curled asleep across two seats, and the coiffed blonde lady confined to her wheelchair up front next to piled luggage. It's mostly black folk, some trickling home in high spirits, bits of inaugural bunting and patriotic ribbons swaying from their suitcase handles on the overhead racks, all of us riding the Carolinian home. Farther on, where it's suddenly sailboats and gulls on a nook of the Chesapeake, the banked up railbed cuts through miles of swamp pines and cypress as the train trundles past the odd heron stalking frogs or picking up speed, clatters through open cornfields where for a few seconds Staring through the dirty glass, you can see turkeys scrabbling the stubble. Farther south past Richmond, something like snow or frost glints off a field, and you realize it's just been gleaned of cotton. And this is indeed the South. As if to confirm this fact to all of us on Amtrak, some latter-day Confederate has raised the rebel battle flag in a field of winter wheat. At dusk, just outside Raleigh, the train slows and whistles three sharp calls at a crossing in Kittrell, North Carolina. Along the railroad tracks, under dark cedars, lie graves of Confederates from Petersburg 9 months siege. Men who survived neither battle nor makeshift hospital at the Kittrell Springs Hotel, long gone from the town, where our train now pauses for something up ahead. Nearby in Oxford in 1970, a black GI was shot to death. One of his killers testified he committed suicide coming in here wanting to four-letter word my daughter-in-law. Black vets just back from Vietnam set the town on fire. Off in the night, you could see the flames from these rails that once freighted cotton, slaves, and armies. And now our Amtrak speeds by, passengers chatting or snoozing or just looking out. As we flick on past the shutdown mills, shotgun shacks, collapsed tobacco barns, and the evening fields with their white chapels, where the blood done signed my name is still sung, where the past hovers like smoke or a train whistle's call. I grew up in Bucks County, Pennsylvania. I don't know if you know it or not, but the Delaware runs through it, separating it from New Jersey. And so one Christmas Eve, it was snowing and the ice was on the Delaware, big blocks of it cracking against the big inn that was near where I was standing. And I remembered my history lessons in high school that this is where the Revolutionary War really turned a corner, and I wrote the poem. Out on the freezing Delaware, ice sheets bob the surface, breaking against granite pilings of the Colonial River Inn, swept by winter storm. Gusts of snow blow off a sandbar and sink in plunging currents, where a line of ducks paddles hard against blizzard. As cornfields on the Jersey banks are whisked into bits of stalks and broken sheaves spinning in the squalls. This is where one such Christmas night, the tall, courtly general with bad teeth risked his neck and his rebels to cross the storming river and rout the Hessians. What made them think they could succeed? Farmers mostly, leaving homesteads to load cannon into Durham boats, to row into the snowstorm, then march all night to Trenton, saving the Republic for Valley Forge and victory at Yorktown. Before crossing, legend says, they assembled in the snow to hear Thomas Paine's new essay about summer soldiers and sunshine patriots. What words could call us all together now? On what riverbank? For what common good would we abandon all? I'll read two more. Maybe just one more. You know the poet Anna Akhmatova, Russian woman, great poet. I was living in Miami at the time and reading her poems in translation, the Stanley Kunitz, Max Hayward translation, really beautiful. And I left the book by mistake out on the on a bench. And when I found it again, it was all puffed up with dew and salt. And looking at it, I began thinking this poem. So here's the title. This will be my last tonight. Anna Akhmatova spends the night on Miami Beach. Well, her book, anyway. The Kunitz volume, left lying on a bench, the pages a bit puffy by morning, flushed with dew, riffled by sea breeze, scratchy with sand. The paperback with the 1930s photo showing her in spangled kaftan, its back cover calling her, quote, star of the St. Petersburg Circle of Pasternak, Mandelstam, and Bloch, surviving the Revolution and two World Wars. So she'd been through worse. The months outside of Lefortovo prison, waiting for a son who was already dead, watching women stagger and reel with news of executions, or one mother asking, can you write about this? Akhmatova thinking, then answering, yes. If music lured her off the sandy bench to the clubs where men were kissing, être outré wouldn't have concerned her much, nor the vamps sashaying in leather. Decadence amid Art Deco fit nicely with her black dress, chopped hair, Chanel cap. What killed her was the talk, the empty eyes, which made her long for the one person in 10,000 who could say her name, who could take her home, giving her a place between Auden and Apollinaire, to whom she could describe her night's excursion amid the loud hilarities, the consuming hungers, arriving toward the end of the American era. And thank you. Do you have any questions? I'd be happy to answer if you do.
We're in the back.
Oh, you need a microphone here. He's got one.
The Vietnamese people are quite long-lived, aren't they? I seem to recall looking on internet, and I saw some kings from centuries ago who were over 400 or 500 years old. Do you have any knowledge of this from the history that you've looked at?
John, would you go back to the mic because the cameras can't catch you?
I think the family line can last the 500 years, and that would be a wonderful thing for that particular dynasty, but no one lives that long in Vietnam.
General Jop lived to be 101?
General Jop was 101. In fact, I have him holding a copy, a photograph of him holding a copy of Spring Essence. He wanted me to translate his biography. Would have been a life work. I didn't want to do it, though. Yeah. Anything else?
This is your time to ask. Don't be bashful.
There you go.
There you go.
Okay, I was just curious, how long were you in Vietnam?
Didn't hear you.
How long were you in Vietnam for? Just when you served in?
Go back to
you. Up here, it's kind of blinding up there. I have, you know, let's see. When I went there in 1968, I left Harvard where I was in graduate school, and I'd gotten it into my head to become a conscientious objector to the war, so I went and worked for a voluntary agency. I hardly knew any Vietnamese at that point, and then gradually learned it and went back for a group of doctors who evacuated war injured children. I was their field representative, and that completed my obligation under the Selective Service Act. And then I went back, because by this time I had really gotten interested in the culture and place. And I got a grant from the State Department and the National Endowment for the Humanities to study Vietnamese in Hawaii all summer. went there with my wife. We stopped in Japan. I bought a tape recorder. I knew there was one of the kind I could use, it not too heavy, a carry around with me in Vietnam. So that was 1971, 72. And then I got interested in this writing system that Tom Keener mentioned, realized how important it was to save the works that are in it. And with those two friends in 1998, the year one of those books came out, I began, I was in Miami teaching, and there, I used to go shooting pacifists. I always was good with guns. My father and brother and I hunted nonetheless. And I remember going out with lawyers in Miami, not every Sunday, but maybe every other Sunday, into the Everglades and shoot sporting clays. And I told them about these things I was doing, and they set up the foundation pro bono and have helped it run for 20 years. And it ended just a year ago. And that's that biography. Yeah. Well, thanks.
I have a question.
Okay.
Here's the guy. Here.
Go ahead.
Let me bring you the mic.
Yeah.
Words that sounded like, at least anyway, dinky-dow. Does that sound anything?
Say it again.
Dinky-dow.
Crazy.
Crazy.
Yeah.
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
I heard them over there.
Yeah. Actually, there's a great poem called Dien Kadao, called Crazy. God, I can't remember the name of the poet that wrote it. American poet, Black GI. I'm ashamed of myself. Yeah, your question.
On your book, Empires, I've studied a lot about the various empires in the Middle East. And some of them are very, very powerful for 400 years or 300 years or 800 years. Then all of a sudden they go into the ground, never to be heard from again. How does that make you feel when you hear that how empires come and go? And then you mentioned that tremors can end an empire overnight.
Yeah, I mean, we may be in such a moment now. I mean, how long has our empire run? And that's what that poem about Washington's crossing is hinting at, I suppose. It was a genuine perplexity on my part, because those men, not to mention the families they left behind and the sacrifices those farmer families made, took off in the winter across and to fight a great army. There's more to that particular skirmish. It was more than a skirmish. The British, thinking they had Washington and his troops, now that they exposed themselves, were taking advantage of it. And Washington had come back across the Delaware, was in the Pennsylvania side again, talking with his lieutenants, and they agreed to re-attack, figuring out that the British would figure out that they would be running across and would be vulnerable. They crossed the river again, and they took Princeton. They completely bypassed the conventionality of the British military mind. How did such people think they could do that? And does our country now have any kind of united vigor or a common belief? It certainly doesn't seem so, given the debates that are going on in the current election. So then one wonders, at least I do, I'm sure you do, how deleterious, how destructive to the national well-being has already been worked out upon us, and can we repair it? Is it reparable? Can there be a reigniting of any kind of vigor and togetherness, I guess? Does that answer? Go ahead.
It does. When I read about these empires being so mighty and fortuitous and strong, and then all of a sudden they just disappear into the dirt, it really humbles the soul.
It does. At least, probably everyone here. Anyone else? Well, I'm going to say good night and thank you again.